Sri J. Lakhani, an excellent communicator of Hinduism in Britain and director of the HinduAcademy, the Vivekananda Centre in London. Over the last 15 years, Sri Lakhani has given talks on Hinduism to thousands of youngsters at English schools, colleges, and universities. If you wish to get a glimpse of the modern, dynamic face of Hinduism, then do not miss this series of talks.
Whenever I, for example, talk to people who are not Hindus about Hinduism, they say, Mr. Lakhani, you are nice, rounded people, and you integrate so well in our society, you know, you contribute well in the economic field, professionals, you are such lovely, gentle people, but, you've got a problem. Your religion is so weird. How can you, this is just too much. And so, it's weird, yes, you've got elephant-headed gods, monkey-faced gods, and do you know, not one or two, that you're teeming, go to any temple, all the walls are covered with gods and goddesses. What is going on? You are a weird, lovely people, but weird religion. How do you explain this? So this is how I'll start my journey.
Yeah.
Despite appearances, and if you, by the way, if you ask any Hindu, do you have many gods? They'll go, yes, Shiva, Vishnu, Mother Goddess, yes. Are they ultimate? They'll go, yes, ultimate. They're all ultimate? Yes. But you can't have more than one ultimate, it's not ultimate enough. Something is wrong here, it's contradiction in terms. So what's going on actually? It appears like a very naive polytheist religion, belief in lots of gods and goddesses, polytheism. It sounds, you know, kind of, come on, it's naive, it's almost childish. This is the first reaction you get from people who are not aware of, the Hindus themselves are confused about it. And the response is very beautiful. He says, we have never been a polytheist tradition, despite appearance and despite what the Hindus tell you. We have always been a very ancient, very majestic, pluralistic tradition. Not polytheist, pluralistic tradition. There's a big difference. Pluralism says you can become spiritual using plural ways, many different ways. And different human beings, inspired by different prophets, will try and, in a way, try and become spiritual using that method suggested by the prophets. So it's pluralism, many ways to achieve spirituality or progress spiritually. This is the breadth of vision. It's a very broad idea and very central idea. And the reason why I'm throwing it in right at the start is this. This idea that appears like a weirdness of the Hindus, in fact, holds a prescription for the most serious issue we face in the world today. Conflict in the name of religion. This pluralism has the answer because it recognizes a variety of different expressions of spirituality over a historic period and it allows for it. It doesn't say, oh, you must snuff them out. It doesn't say that. It allows everybody to progress spiritually from where they are. This is the breadth of vision. Now, you see, this sounds a bit philosophic and, you know, late in the evening, what is all this? So I must lighten up and I do this on TV quite often and some of you have heard this story, so please bear with me. And I go to a lot of primary schools, Catholic primary, they invite me for assemblies. There are a lot of little children sitting cross-legged. Mr. Lakhani, tell us about Hinduism, tell us about Hinduism. I say, but before I start, my boys and my girls, my little daughters, I have a question for you. Do you think of God like your Father in heaven? These are Catholic school children. They look at each other, what a stupid question. What kind of guy is this? Because their main prayer is God our Father in heaven. Why is he asking silly questions like this? They say, yeah, we like to think God like a father. I say, wonderful idea. Many Hindus also like to think God like a fatherly figure, like Shiva, like Vishnu, like Ram. Like, it's a lovely idea. It's a lovely chap, this God looking after you. So nice idea. But you've got a problem. You see that little chap in the corner? He keeps tugging my sleeve, saying, I don't want God to be my daddy. I say, why can't? It's a nice idea. Why can't God be your daddy? No, he said, I don't want God to be my daddy. What's your problem? He said, last night when I was having supper, some food fell accidentally on the floor. My daddy saw it on the, he stood up at the dining table, waved his finger at me and said, naughty boy, no supper, no TV, go to your room. And I started to cry. And then my mommy came in the room and she saw me crying. She said, come here, my baby. And she gave me a hug. And then she gave me a jam donut. And if it's a Gujarati mommy, you get gulab jambus. And so the boy says, why shouldn't God like my daddy in heaven? Daddies are so rough and tough and so hairy. Why can't I think God like my mommy in heaven? They are sweet and kind and cuddly and hopefully less hairy than daddy's. I said, my boy, you like to think God like your mommy in heaven? Go for it. God is your mommy in heaven. This is called pluralism. Not many gods. Many ways to relate to this supreme personality in different ways, different names and different forms. And I'm not just conjuring it up just because we live in a modern world. This is the most ancient teaching of the Hindus. It says, Ekam Asatya Vipra Bahudha Vadanti. The same ultimate can be approached in a variety of different ways. This is the basis, foundation of the Hindu tradition. So it's not something new I'm conjuring up. So this is, if you like, just to show you, this religion that we come from, the tradition we come from, is very broad, very vast, and very majestic and very mature. It's not some naive polytheist enterprise. And why is it so important? I'll do a funny story just to lighten you up, and then of course you are going to fire me with pointed questions. Again, I use this story not only at primary school, I use it at theology colleges, Canterbury Christchurch or Oxford University. And the theologians get really worked about it, but I'm going to reuse the story on here. I say, why is pluralism so important? Again, I do it through a story, because story carries tremendous power, power of narration, boom, grab your attention. So I say, there are two boys, the best of friends, playing football, kicking the ball around. One boy said, what? You know what, my mom is best in the world. Boys like talk like that. The other boy says, your mom is the best in the world? Rubbish. My mom is best in the world, she cooks the best food. Boys love food, especially mommy's food. She cooks the best food. The first boy says, your mommy cooks the best food? You brought those homemade cakes last week? They were like rocks. You could break windows with those. Your mommy's cooking is rubbish. You tell any boy of any age, including your husband's, that their mommy's cooking is suspect. It is the beginning of World War III. And boys being boys, they like to solve things physically. So they're all of this, I told you, my mother, they're thumping, they whack each other, they're thumping, they're both bleeding, they love their mommies. A wise man passed me and said, hang on, why? Oh, my mommies, okay, calm down, says the wise man. Let me give you a solution. Say with all the love and devotion you can muster, my mommy is best. But then add two magic words at the end of your sentence. The boys like magic, Harry Potter, both magic words. Say with all the love and devotion you can muster, my mom is best for me. The boy said, that's exactly what we meant. My mommy doesn't know this chap. In 2 minutes, they become best of friends and start playing football again. The problem is gone away. This is what I'm telling people of religion, all religions. I said, my friends, affirm with all the love and devotion you can muster, my religion is best, or my sectarian movement is the best. But remember to use those magic words. For me, my family, my congregation, my community, not necessarily for the rest of humanity. Because when you impose your religion, others, you are basically saying, you know, you're imposing your mommies on them. They've got their own mommies, leave them alone. This is the power of pluralism. You may think such a simple idea, such a lovely idea. The world should adopt this earlier the better, otherwise we'll become more bloodshed in the name of religion. When you have people fighting in the name of religion, this is the reason. They say, our mommy is the best, you lot are all doomed. Then trouble. This is why what appears as the weirdness of Hinduism, in fact, is a prescription most suited to the time that we live in. To remove the most serious issue we face, fighting in the name of religion. Once you present this idea, how can you have fighting? This is his way, this is my way. This suits his own temperament, his background, his cultural background, family background. Let him progress that way. Why should I interfere? This is the breadth, this is the why this religion has a lot to offer in the world that we live in. So anyway, I've just given you a brief introduction to Hinduism to give you an idea regarding what we are talking about, or why we can remove serious misconception and present this kind of more dynamic vision.
It's regarding the Hindu teaching of reincarnation. And how I understand some people, I'm not saying all people, use the word karma to say if you're born poor, you're at the bottom of the caste system, that's your fault, and therefore justifies them not politically trying to solve the issues of poverty. So I'd like to ask you, what do you understand reincarnation is? Can we use karma in a sense of in the now to end poverty, or do we say that's their problem? Thank you.
You give a round of applause. This one. I was hoping this, I will answer, normally I'll give you 2 or 3 minutes. This one I'll answer by 5 minutes because it's such an important question. First of all, reincarnation is a central feature of all the 4 Indian religions, Hinduism, Buddhism, Jainism, and Sikhism. It's a central feature. You can't be Hindu without believing in reincarnation. Okay. But then we also have another issue, which is a central belief of the Hindus, or all the Indian religions, by the way, all the Indic religions, reincarnation and the law of karma are central for all the 4 Indian religions. Now what is this law of karma? Let me tidy up, because the Hindus are very bad at this. The law of karma simply says we observe the universe around us and we see that objects and events are strongly intertwined. They follow in a particular manner. There's cause and effect, the way things unfold. This is just observation of the world that we see strongly intertwined through cause and effect, straightforward. My background is theoretical physics, and physics is just doing that, looking at the causal relationship between when you put certain things together, certain results will follow. This is what science is all about, looking at causality, cause and effect. Fair enough, so far so good. Now the Hindus said, let's use this in human terms. And this is called the law of karma. It's become part of the Western vocabulary, because when things go wrong for a Westerner, you say, oh, my karma catching up, okay, calm down. So what's this karma, what's this karma? The idea is this. They said that if, for example, you are a disciplined individual, you pursue a particular project, and you've been very hardworking, like the little young lady there, then you'll succeed. You become a lecturer, professor, whatever, you'll succeed in your field because you put in so much effort. This is the simple idea of law of cause and effect. The activity you do will certainly have certain consequences that you have to bear. Simple as that. Sounds sensible, nothing so far wrong. But how have we got it wrong? This is what the gentleman has pointed out. We've got it seriously wrong. 2 ways, we got it seriously wrong. Number one, what you set into motion or try and achieve will certainly produce certain benefit and your contribution is there. But a lot of other things gang up again as well to bring about a result. Not only you working hard and studying your subject, your mommy dragging you to the tuition lesson, all this participates. A lot of other things gang up before a result takes place, before a consequence takes place. So it's not just your contribution that you get this. A lot of other things gang up either in your favor or against you. They gang up against you in many cases. You may be a very intelligent person, but things go so badly wrong, you can't study. So that's not your fault. Things gang up against you. The tsunami hits you, whatever. So things have a habit, not just what you set into motion going to catch up with you, but a lot of other things also contribute to the result. Not only you, your own contribution may be minuscule, maybe it's tiny. Recognize this is the mature idea of law of karma. Your action will produce certain result, but it is limited. This is the part the Hindus have forgotten. When things go wrong, you know what a Hindu will, oh, I must have done bad in my past life, so it's catching up with me, I'm a fatalist, I deserve it. Utter rubbish. Things will gang up against you whether you like it or not. Even the goody-goody things will gang up against you, promise. Haven't you seen a lot of goody-goody people struggling like hell and a lot of nasty people having the best time? Things gang up in this unique manner, either gang up in your favor or against you. Nothing to do with you, your karma, nothing to do with it. You just had little contribution. This is the mature idea of law of karma. The Hindus have forgotten this and they become fatalist. Anytime things go wrong, oh, I deserve it. You don't deserve it. The law of karma, to the contrary, says the opposite. It says when things gang up, they are going to gang up against each and every one of us. When they gang up against you, do you know what you do? Said the law of karma. We told you are in charge of your destiny. Now, roll up your sleeves and come fighting. Sort yourself out. Get out of your trouble. This is the law of karma, mature law of karma. It puts you in charge of it. You think, okay, things will gang up against me. I'm going to fight against it. Overcome these obstacles and get over it. This is the mature law of karma. The Hindus say, oh no, we deserve it. Must have done bad thing in my past life. Utter rubbish. That's one part. The second part that really hurts me even more. And I'm pointing this goes to India. What's up? 1 million people watch it every day. Let it go back. The second part of law of karma that Hindus have forgotten is this. It's not only what you set into motion has got a habit of catching up with you, what you fail to do, suppose something, a situation arises in front of you and you turn your back and you fail to take action, that is bad karma too, isn't it? Suppose you know you are living in Hemel-Hempstead and just near the winter time and little leak in the attic, little leak going on in the water, you say, well, when I come back from Florida, don't go to Florida, by the way. When I come back from Florida, I'll get it repaired. And you go away in the severe winter and the pipe bust. And when you come back, your house is swimming pool. Who is to blame? You, because you saw an issue in front of you, you turned your back. You got whacked. This is the second part of law of karma. Not only what you set into motion is going to catch up with you, what you fail to do is going to catch up and whack you as well. Remember, this is the second part. Again, the Hindus have forgotten completely. And this is why, do you know why you have such a huge difference between heavens and hell notes in India today? Why today? Law of karma misunderstood, severely misunderstood. I'm promising you this. Suppose you go to India today, suppose you go to a friend's family, you go there, oh, you party and you got wedding and all these flowers and all this feasting and dancing and all the going on. So far, so good. Then you step out of the house of your relation and you see a little destitute girl standing there, hungry, destitute, no protection, no money, no food, looking at the festivities. You will be, if you come from London, you see an egalitarian society, you feel you don't like it. You jump in the, go inside the house, bring your host out. What about her? What about her? You know what answer you're going to get? Promise. Don't worry. She must have done bad things in her past life and her karma na bhogve. Let us pay her price for past karma. We did good things, so we dance about with kurtas. This is why the biggest difference of heavens and heaven in India, law of karma misunderstood. So what the gentleman asked was so important. That's why I'm going to spend a lot of time on it. This message has to go back to modern India, that you have misunderstood your own religion. It's the oversimplistic understanding of law of karma creates this huge difference between heaven and heaven. You become indifferent to the suffering of others. How dare you do that? And do you know how it catches up with them? Let me tell you. In one life, they are dancing kurtas and all this funny business going on. In the next life, law of averages, they'll be down there, starving. And those guys who are starving will be up there dancing. The solution has not come about. You still left this big gap. It's going to hit you. I told you. When you ignore a situation in front of your eyes, it's going to come and bite you. This is how they pay a price. Just switch from here to there. If you reduce this gap right from day one, it doesn't matter the difference whether you're born here or there. You're okay. You've got a big car, I've got a small car. Micra, how about that? So this important idea the Hindus have, I'm telling you, this is such a serious mistake, and I'm really rubbing this into the Indian market, saying please understand your religion in a mature manner, not in this over simplistic manner where you become indifferent to the suffering of others. Not allowed. Sorry, I got wound up on this one.
I understand Hinduism is a very pluralistic religion. I remember hearing Gandhi say, I'm a Hindu, I'm a Jew, I'm a Christian, I'm a Muslim. But I also understand that there is a rise of something very new in Hinduism, fundamentalists, that believe that their way is the only way and anyone else is not right. Could you explain, where does this fundamentalism come from? Is this really Hinduism? And what is the solution? Thank you.
I asked for a pointed question, you give me two pointed questions straight away. First of all, let us look at the history of the Hindus in general. Just general comment. When you look at the history of humanity, the only nation that has welcomed people from other religion and allowed them to integrate and stay with them without conversion, without any pressure, without any taxation, only nation in the world that has allowed people of other religions to come and exist within them without any imposition is Hindus, I'm telling you. Let me give you the history. You can have a blip. Let me give you the total history. See the overall situation. The ancient Christian Syrians were persecuted. It's nothing new now. They were persecuted. Where did they find their home? In India. They're still there, allowed to practice their religion without any imposition, without any attempt to convert or tax them. The ancient Jews were struggling when the temple was destroyed. A lot of them ended up in India, and they still live there as Yahudis. And they practice their religion with full flow, no problem. What about the Baha'is? Where's the largest Baha'i temple? Again, India said, come, build it here. What about the most important, the Zoroastrian religion, the more ancient religion than even the Hebrew religion, the Parsis. The first religion in the Middle East was not Hebrew, not Judaism, it was Zoroastrianism. These lovely people, they are lovely people, were persecuted, they were going to be murdered or converted. And shiploads of them went, left Persia, ancient Persia, arrived in India, Gujarat, near Surat. And they have become part of the Indian community, Parsis. They eat Gujarati food, speak better Gujarati than I do, with tremendous humor. And they have been major philanthropic contributors toward India today. Major contributors, a small population, like the Tatas, they are Zoroastrian. And when I go to an interfaith meeting, I go to many interfaith meetings, If it is a Zoroastrian, he'll stand with Mr. Lakhani, do you know why I'm still a Zoroastrian? Because of you, they allowed us to exist, continue to exist as a religion. So they have got home in India. Where did the Dalai Lama live?
India.
Not China, not Tibet, India. So we have a very positive track record about linking with people of other religion as well as no religion. We never vilified them, we allowed them to stay with us. But what is happening now? This is what the gentleman is asking. Look, actually, that nation has stayed together as a single civilization over 5,000 years because it focused on higher principles, not material gains, not to conquer other people or pillage other people. Higher principles were the aim of that nation. Because it was focusing on higher ideals, it has stayed together as a single civilization over 5,000 years. The aim was always spiritual, not secular, not material. And then what did we do? We said, oh, we must follow the Western example. We must become secular. Sounds so good, but their secularism is so immature, it's frightening. So they kicked out spirituality and brought in secularism. Do you know how bad it is? Just give an example. I can teach Hinduism at every school in the United Kingdom, and I teach at Eton College. Happily, they welcome me, they embrace me, they pay me even. I can't teach Hinduism to a single Indian government school. You know that? This is this Indian secularism. They threw religion out of the system. And then you get all this corruption, all these guys filling their pocket. The whole system collapsed. Because the aim of the religion was always spirituality. And they threw it out, and the nation collapsed. That's why corruption is the name of the game in India today. Because the central feature of the religion, which was focusing on values and morality, thrown out. So what is happening now with this modern kind of political movement? Look, I'm not a politician. I'm not here to promote one individual or a political party, but I'm simply saying that nation is stirring up, saying that the model that we adopted of secularism does not agree with our constitution, our makeup. We need a spiritual model rather than a secular model. And this is what is happening. This is the stirring that we see. And I welcome it, not because I'm welcoming people being, beaten up or something. That's the last thing the Hindus want to do, beat up or hit people of other religion. Or we've never done it. That's not in our system. We are pluralist through and through. But you will have blips, my friend. You will have blips. You will have some fanatic element, but that is available in every society, everywhere, including UK. You will have blips. But look at the overall, if you like, overall kind of history of how Hindus interact with people of other religion as well as no religion. It is very positive. But the good thing is, I like the stirring that I see in modern India. This idea of spitting out secularism and adopting spiritual ideals. Hopefully, I told Narendra Modi's government, bring Hinduism back in the syllabus in schools. You've thrown it out. How dare you? Put it back. And do you know what is the problem? He can't get it done, even though if he wants to, because there's so much opposition, the so-called secular forces won't allow him. But this is the world that we face today. But it'll come through.
There's Hinduism and Hindutva. Can you explain a little bit of a subtle difference between the two words, at least, actually, what they are actually trying to say or teach us or actually progress further, at least? Okay, so that's one question. The second question is, obviously, in Hinduism, we have lots of things, at least, that doing this is good for you, this is bad for you, or whatever. So we don't have actually 10 commandments, but they are like commandments, actually. So could you, if I decided, at least, I just want to follow one commandment, which one should I follow?
Okay, first of all, as you most of you hopefully know, Christianity, the reason why you are Christian is because you follow the teachings of Christ. Wonderful idea. You are Buddhist because you follow the teaching of Buddha. Wonderful. And of course, long time ago, we had a Mr. Hindu. We said, hello, chaps, follow me. I'm Mr. Hindu. You become Hindus. You actually believe that? I hope not. I'm worried now. We didn't have Mr. Hindu. So what is the word Hindu and Hinduism, Hindutva? What is the background to it? The word Hindu is just nothing more than a mispronunciation of the name of an ancient river called River Sindhu that flowed in northwest part of India, ancient India. It was called Sindhu. And Sindhu in Sanskrit means a river, large flow of water. That's what it literally means. So that was the name. And somehow it got mispronounced and people blamed the Persians saying they messed it up and called it Hindu instead of Sindhu. Sa became her. I say no, I suspect the Gujaratis are responsible. Especially if you come from Kathiawad and Kutch. We've got a habit of changing the sa into ho. Have you noticed that? Instead of saying su haim ja, hu haim ja, hakna beho, like that. So we turned the sa into ho. Maybe we are to blame, but we like to point a finger at the Persians. But the sa became her, and that's how the word Hinduism arose. So it has no real Sanskrit meaning as such. Mispronounced name of a river, Sindhu. And then the story went further, right? Just out of interest, I'm telling you. Then we had the Greeks turning up and their problem with the ha sound. They turned the ha into a. The river Sindhu had become Hindu, is down into Indo, Indus. And they say people living river, across the river Indus are people of Indoi, India. See, even the name of the country is mispronunciation of the river. So that's how we're stuck, but so be it. So what is this idea? The name that we give to our tradition, if I can use the right word, is dharma. Now dharma means something quite different from the word religion. Religion means realigning humanity with some super personality called God. Hello, dear God, I'm here, link of humanity. This is religion. The four Indian traditions, I've used the word tradition, Hinduism, Buddhism, Jainism, Sikhism, none of them use the word religion. Actually, even though we use it, you know, in a very casual manner, the word is dharma, they're all dharmic tradition. Even the Buddhists call it dhamma, it's dharmic tradition. What's the difference? Dharma's, the enterprise of dharma is saying, make sense of the human condition, resolving it here and now. This is the meaning of the word dharma. What is underpinning this reality? Let me come to terms with it. Who am I? What am I doing here? Let me sort myself out. This is the enterprise of dharma. So in Buddhism, there's no God, for example. So dharma is a different word. Now, how does the word, so the Hinduism, as I said, is a meaningless word, really. And the reason why the word Hindutva arose, let me tell you the background, is this. People get worked up. They say, when you say ism, means it's something that's output of something else. You know, ism means it is something that has been compromised. That is why the people who are very worked about Hindu, you know, they say, we don't want to use Hinduism, we say Hindutva. The essence of this tradition, essence of this, this is what it means, literally means. So Hindutva is basically to shy away from the word ism. That's the reason why they invented it. It's just play of words, basically, when you think about it. Nothing serious. Neither of them does justice to what this tradition is all about, which is dharma, making sense of the human condition.